Linda Audio presents this unabridged recording of The Stone Testament, written by Celia Rees and read by Colin Moody. The dedication reads, "For Roy and Owain, who both loved fantasy." And you believe that there are such things? Oh, I think so, yes. I believe I could give you convincing evidence on that point. But I want to know whether you seriously think that there is any foundation of fact beneath these fancies. Is it not all a department of poetry, a curious dream with which man has indulged himself? I can only say that it is no doubt better for the great mass of people to dismiss it all as a dream. The White People, Arthur Machen. This might suggest that the so-called imaginary time is really the real time, and that what we call real time is just a figment of our imaginations. A Brief History of Time, Stephen W. Hawking. Can such things be? Can such things be? Ambrose Bierce. Elder Time. Chapter 1, The Eye of the Sea. Mikkel sang the song of leaving. The land was doomed to die, along with all living plants and beings. The only way to survive was to depart. He was so intent on his lament and the task that he had been set that he did not notice how cold it was, or how frost had formed on his hair and on his brows and lashes. He had been here for more than a day, sitting cross-legged and motionless, high on the cliff above the Cape of Souls, where three oceans met. The land fell sheer to the raging water, and then down still further to the depths of the abyss. The waves crashed against the towering cliffs, rebounding as if from the end of the world. They collapsed back into a furious chaos of white water, which turned in wide spirals, slowly at the outside, but then faster and faster, tighter and tighter, moving always towards one central pool which lay directly below the face of the cliff. Here the water was still and black, solid like glass. The Eye of the Sea. There was something different about the bulging lens of water, something wrong. The boy was disturbed in some deep way, but knew better than to stare into the terrifying swirl of currents. To look would mean to be sucked down as surely as any ship, as surely as the spirits of the departing dead who whispered past him on the final stage of their journey. In a late, stuttering rush, the souls of men, women, and children came skittering round him, like dead leaves blown on the wind. The number of the dead had been growing. Some of those who had drawn black instead of white in the selection had elected to leave by their own hand, and smoke still billowed from the funeral pyres of those taken by plague and famine. Calls for greater sacrifice meant incense choked the air above the temple of the beast gods, and the steps were slick with blood. The precincts rang day and night with prayer and chanting, but the gods were not appeased. It was not enough. It would never be enough. There had been desperate reports even before he left the city. Weary patrols had returned from the outlying areas, hardened soldiers sickened by what they had seen. The beast gods were coming down from the mountain, destroying all in their path. Stories spread quickly throughout the city. How the gods fed on the flesh of every living thing, marking no difference between men and animals. How they had become so gorged and glutted that they only consumed the choicest, tearing out the heart and liver, breaking open the brain pan to get at the meat like a man might crack a nut. Mikkel's heart became heavy with new dread. What would they do when they reached the city and discovered the betrayal that awaited them? He would not allow these thoughts to distract him, or acknowledge the souls who passed him, or listen to their complaints and lamentations. He had been left here as part of the great purpose, where all must act as one. He kept his eyes fixed on the curving rim of the horizon, trying to see past it to the seas beyond these seas. His ears were attuned to the stillness below the roar of the swirling, restless, frothing surface of the water as he listened for the vast creatures of the deep ocean. He could hear them singing, calling to each other, but they were very distant, a faint sound. The grunts of hunting seals, the whistling clicks of dolphins and porpoises, the chirps of the flightless birds which darted among them, these were all much louder, but he ignored them. These creatures kept close to the coast and were not useful. Only the creatures who ranged across the vast emptiness of the open ocean could sing to him of the sea roads, the routes that ships should take across the watery wastes, and what hazards they might encounter. This was what he had been put here to learn. His head turned to the northeast. A series of stuttering notes, faint but strong, clanged inside his skull and pulsed through his brain. The sound was coming from one of the great-toothed, blunt-headed whales. The pulse received no answering chatter. A lone bull. The boy waited for him to get nearer before he sent out his own signal. There it was again, this time much stronger. He put his tongue to the roof of his mouth to approximate the clicking noise, although that was not necessary. He was sending out his thought, dressed in sounds that the creature would understand. In return, he heard only the shrilling of the wind, the pounding surf, the roar of turning water, the scratchy scatter of snow pellets. The silence around him spread to the other animals. Seals, dolphins, porpoises, birds all fell silent. The great beast was coming closer. They were curious creatures, curious and intelligent. He would want to know who was summoning him from the shore. He was lying off to the east, a double stone's throwing distance from the cliffs. The boy heard the whispering hiss before he saw the white spray of the spout. The gray back just broke the surface like a rolling log. He hung there waiting, listening to the boy explaining. Then with a flick of his tail, he was gone in a rapid burst of sound. The boy had a quick plunging vision, a mirror shimmer of bubbles, deep indigo blue, then sickening blackness and cold. He cleared his head of that and smiled to himself. When he was given the ruler and dividers, he would know where to put them, how to move them across the map. The sound started again, echoing against the case of his head, vibrating through the bones of his face. Loud, soft, loud, soft. The voice of the largest of all. More than one individual. They drew closer, stopping further offshore. He could not see their narrow blue forms through the sleet and covering water, but he could hear their voices. They were vast, their length twice that of the tallest tree in the forest, and they ranged through many seas. He listened intently to their song. Their language was harder for him to master, but he managed to make himself understood. Their replies nearly deafened him. For such large, stately creatures, they were very talkative. His brain struggled to take in all he was being told, not only the best way to cross the trackless ocean, but of other lands, how large they were, how far. They also spoke of great changes in other places, freezings, floods, new seas forming, dry land disappearing and appearing where none had been before. He thanked them and braced himself for the juddering coldness of their leaving. He had not been instructed to find out about other countries, merely to learn the sea roads. Nevertheless, such information was useful and could be vital. There was no point in setting sail for lands as threatened as their own. He pulled his reed cloak tighter around him. The sea was barely visible, a glitter of black through whirling snowflakes. Inland, ice was edging down from the mountains, filling the valleys like splayed fingers pushing towards the sea. In some places, the ice creep had already reached the ocean. Huge blocks fell away with great groaning crashes, pushed by the inexorable weight of the mass behind. The chatter of the smaller sea creatures had started again. The birds on the ledges below argued and chattered, Beaks clicked and snicked as the young ones preened with long bills, working quickly to remove any remaining down from their wings. Little fuzzy feathers floated up on the wind. The birds were making ready to leave. Some had gone already. Only the hardiest would remain here. They must fly to warmer lands in the north. Even the deep ocean was preferable to this land in winter. He wondered what he could learn from them, but bird brains held little. His attention shifted away from the squabbling colony. Someone was coming up the path behind him. She stepped softly, carefully, but still he could hear her feet brushing against the short, frozen stalks of grass, the creaking leather soles of her shoes. He knew who his visitor was, but she had closed herself from him, one of the few who had that skill. The surface of her mind was as black and shiny as the glass of the knife she was easing from its scabbard. She was behind him now. He could hear her breathing, light and natural, despite the steepness of the climb. He'd been expecting her to come for him. He could not read her intention, but he could hear the whisper of blade against well-oiled leather. He sensed a momentary hesitation, but did nothing. Before him lay the great eye of the sea. Behind him stood a warrior of the goddess, poised to kill. Time to Come. Chapter 2. Hope for a Better Day. Everyone was dead. Not just in that room, but in the next and the next. She knew because the flies told her. One or two at first, in aimless, heavy flight, buzzed and banged against the windows. But the weather had been very warm, freakishly so for the time of year, and now the sound was a constant, busy, monotonous drone as if the many had become one. She could feel the imprint of their tiny, clawed feet as they crawled across her face, her hands, every part of her body that was exposed. But still, she did not move. Even the flicker of an eyelid would give her away. The flies did not come alone. Baal-Zebul moved with them. This was how she knew him. He had been given many titles over the millennia, but the meaning of his name was always the same, Lord of the Flies. The destruction would be general. The fifth age of the world would end in fire and flood, tempest and tumult. The beast gods would stalk the land, and only the children of the sixth dawn had been forewarned. Not just here, but in identical communities all over the country, all over the world, the children of the sixth dawn, C6D for short, had left early, going to another level to await the end time, the final setting of the sun. She had been taken young. She did not know her age, or her true name, or the place of her birth. She had no memory of the time before they took her. But sometimes, in dreams, she saw a place that was very different from this. A place that was the color of ashes. A land of craters and ruins where a hot wind always blew and the dust was white with stinging salts. Sometimes she saw a ruined settlement. Mud huts, crumbling to dust, straggled out of a burning town. Behind them, a dried-up lake. Behind that, a line of grey hills riven with black gullies. In front lay a highway with no traffic on it. A thin dog tore and worried at a lump of something that lay beside a wreck at the roadside. She knew there were people, crouched in the corner on the mud-stamped floor of a hut half-destroyed by rocket fire. But there were no people in her dreams. There were never any people in her dreams. She was always alone, tasting the bitter wind. They had probably purchased her. When they were harvesting, they went well equipped with dollars. They went to countries which were poor to begin with, torn by war and conflict, where there was no lack of people willing to sell their children. They had given her a name, Zillah. They consulted a name book when they took in new children, working through A to Z and back again, as methodical in this as in everything else. She had no surname, no family name. She was a true child of the sixth dawn. That was 7 years ago.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.